The College of Complexes will now be brought to order. My name is Tim. I'd like to welcome all of you to the College of Complexes tonight. Tonight's speaker will be Paul Rescino, who's now passing out a handout, and he's going to be talking about why I'm a Christian and why I plan to celebrate Christmas. The college consists of the following formats. There will be a brief announcements period, followed by our presenter, Paul Rescino, followed by a question and answer period, followed by our infamous rebuttal period.
I have nothing to report on events for the coming week. There's literature for groups on the back. But January 9th, although I'm not a capitalist, I will give an advertisement for our upcoming program. Our own Tim Bulger will speak in, he's going to talk about the next 100 years and how beneficial multinational corporations are for us and things like that, right? Anyhow.
Do you want to sit on this side?
All right.
A forecast. Capitalism. The Force Awakens.
Oh. All right, go ahead, Charlie.
Where's Heather? Is Heather around anywhere? Okay. Oh. I just wanted to give a little thing here to our long suffering. There's just some Mickey's here. To remember her individually for fine service here, but thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you.
Aww.
All right.
Aww. Thank you.
All right.
I got you later.
Oh, wow. That was heavy.
Okay. Now let's welcome Brom Brasford, our moderator.
We have a few rules here. And I want you to know that the first rule is
one rule at a time.
That's so everybody can understand what's going on. And the second rule is don't insult anybody here or their parentage. All right. Now that we've got that straight, what can we say? Tonight, we are hearing from Paul Rescino.
Yes.
Paul has been our factotum. He's been doing everything here. And he's a good guy, helps out, and sometimes speaks. Tells you lots of things about computers and things like that. But tonight he's telling us why he is a Christian. And think of that. And why not? And beyond that, what it means to be a Christian. So, Paul.
We all know that, Charlie.
Thank you, Brom. Charlie, fellow collegians.
We got you on the outside. I don't know if you're
moved for you. Every day we hear about Christians, whether they're being beheaded by ISIS or whatever else. But what truly is a Christian? That's my goal today, is to show you what truly is a Christian. In the Christian church, we have four main beliefs that define what a Christian is. First, the God of the Judeo-Christian Bible exists. Second, the Bible is His Word. Third, that Jesus is God. And fourth, that Jesus died to make atonement for our sins and rose again on the third day.
That's totally true.
I have been a Christian my whole life, so it has been a study of mine my whole life what a Christian is, what makes a Christian what it means to be a Christian. The sources for my material, of course, are the Bible, personal study, things I've looked at, either books or Bible studies or listening to speakers, other speakers, preachers, etc., either live or on TV or on the radio. For tonight, I want to first take a look at who Jesus is, and then take a look at each of these four major points, and then wrap it up by giving a little bit on how you too can be a Christian if you are not, and how to tell, ways you can tell if a person actually is a Christian. If Christ is Jewish, why does he have a Mexican name? Many people speak of Jesus Christ like Jesus is his first name and Christ is his second name. That's not true. Jesus is his name. Christ is his title. The word Christ is the Greek word. The New Testament was written in Greek mostly. The Greek word for the Jewish word Hamashiach or Messiah. In English, it would be the Anointed One. So the proper way of saying it would be Jesus the Christ would be a more proper way of saying it in English. And where is the proof that Jesus was the Messiah? Jesus points out, and you can read in the New Testament, that because of him and his ministry, the blind received sight, the dead were raised, and the good news of God's salvation was preached to all. The Old Testament, which points to Jesus, prophesies Jesus, made strong points on those as things the Messiah would do when he came. Also, from the time of Adam and Eve, when the first sin occurred, God promised someone to come and make things right, which is the role of the Messiah. The two prophets, Daniel and Isaiah, especially prophesy Jesus and his ministry. In the book of Daniel, it speaks of a time of weeks of years. And if you work it out, you work out the math and work out the number of years and days, it points directly to Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, which is celebrated these days as Palm Sunday by Christians, which is the beginning of Holy Week, which is when Jesus went to Jerusalem to give himself as the sacrifice. Also, the book of Isaiah, almost the whole book of Isaiah is prophecies of the Messiah. Isaiah is referred to as the Messianic prophet because he prophesied so much about the Messiah. On the cross, Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? That's a direct quote from a passage in the book of Isaiah. Often during his ministry, when he was teaching a synagogue, he took the scroll of the prophet Isaiah to teach the people because that speaks of him. And at one point, he opened the scroll, read a passage, and even said, the one written here, I am he. And Jesus fulfilled all the prophecies of him in the Old Testament. Let's take a look at the four beliefs of Christians. I have a favorite Bible quiz which I want to share with you, and Tim knows the answer, so he's disqualified. What are the first three words in the beginning of the Bible?
In the beginning.
Yes, yes. And by the fourth word of the Bible, you can divide all of mankind. in the beginning, God. You either believe that God was in the beginning, or you don't. There's no in between. It's yes or no.
No.
Yes.
Yes. And if you don't believe that God was in the beginning, everything from the fifth word of the Bible on means nothing to you. I worked with someone who said, oh, I've read the Bible a couple of times. It's a nice read, but it means absolutely nothing to me. So. I want to take a little look at who God is, what Christians believe God is. God is the creator, as spelled out in the book of Genesis. What is the deal with the creator? A creator automatically becomes a moral authority, someone you have to look up to, someone who makes the rules. Because we are part of and living in his creation. God is eternal. God was, and always will be, no beginning, no end. In Christian philosophy, we refer to that God is self-existent, meaning he's existent in himself. I'm not versed on the whole discussion of that, and it wouldn't really be add anything to the discussion here. In eternity, there is no sense of time. God says, a day, to me, a day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. If there is no beginning, no end, time means nothing. Whereas for us, since we have a beginning and an ending to our earthly lives, time is everything. Because there's someday there will be an end. God also is what we in Christian parlance refer to as Trinity. The word Trinity means three in one, meaning there's one God in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, how this happens, how this works, I don't know either. But it's one of the things we accept by faith and our beliefs in God. And in the Bible, there is actually an appearance of the Trinity at the baptism of Jesus. At that point, Jesus was being baptized by John the Baptist. Jesus was there in human form. God the Father was there in the form of the voice, and the Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus as a dove. So at that point, you could see the full Trinity. And there are other things, such as during the creation story, the voice of God, or whatever you want to say, that is talking, says, let us make man in our image, in plural, not singular. Whereas in Exodus, it says, I, the Lord your God, am one God. So it's one, singular and plural at the same time for God. God referring to himself that way. God is holy and just. Being holy means God is totally and completely without sin. And if any sin were to come into his presence, it would be obliterated instantly. So, the fact is, we are all sinners, and if we ever were in the presence of God, we would be in big trouble. And also, by being holy, God must be just also, because he must demand something in repayment for sin as being just. There's a verse I like, two verses actually. A lot of us, I'm sure you've heard this verse, the wages of sin is death. That is justice. The next verse, but the free gift of God, which is mercy, is life in Christ Jesus, which is grace. Mercy is when you should be punished, but you're not. And grace is when you receive something that you shouldn't. An acronym that I've learned for grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. So the wages of sin is death. That's justice. That's where we would all be if God didn't have mercy on us by giving us life, allowing us to live, and giving his son as the sacrifice, which is grace. And our God is a God of love, in that he did not eliminate the human race at the time of Adam and Eve, which he should have, because of his justice. And he provided his own sacrifice in his son. The next thing is the Bible. There's an acronym I've heard for the Bible also. Basic instruction before leaving Earth. And that's a very accurate summation of what the Bible is. The Bible is God's plan in writing for all of us. It is God's word. One of the ways that he speaks to us is through the Bible. And God's message in the Bible is to all people in all times. The Bible doesn't get outdated. The Bible is always prevalent. A lot of people say, well, the Bible today isn't accurate because we've had all these translations, we've had all these transcriptions by men, and men make mistakes. My personal belief on that is the God who can inspire the men through the Holy Spirit to write his word in the first place should be able to, when someone is working in God's will and has a desire to make a proper representation of the Bible, should be able to send the same spirit to them to keep his word the way he intended it.
I don't know.
The third point, Jesus is God. This is one of the most controversial and where a lot of other religions and sects go astray. Let's take a look at Jesus' birth. His mother Mary never knew a man before Jesus was born. Jesus was conceived through God's power through the Holy Spirit. And Jesus never once in his life sinned. Greg Laurie, who's one of my favorite Bible preachers, says on that, how would you like to have been Jesus' brother? You can see Mary now. Why can't you be more like your brother Jesus? He doesn't do anything wrong. Why can't you be like him? Some of you may know the concept of original sin and say, well, wouldn't Jesus have original sin? Original sin was passed from, since it started with Adam, it was passed from generation to generation through the Father. Since God was Jesus' Father, God doesn't have sin, so Jesus wouldn't have sin. What's the significance of his life other than the ultimate sacrifice? Well, I also heard a story of a man. on his farm, there were some ducks. And it was a very bad storm coming, and he wanted to get the ducks to go into his barn to be safe. And the man said to himself, if only I could be a duck, I could tell them what to do. And that's exactly what Jesus is doing. He became a human so he could experience life as a human. He went through everything we have gone through. He was born. He grew up. He went through adolescence.
Okay.
He was tempted in every way that you can think of, and probably tempted more than most men. And he never sinned or departed from his way. And he came to show us what we should do also. There's a lot of discussion also on, did Jesus ever claim that he was God? I tell you, there is no way you could say that he didn't. There's two things I want to point out in that way. When God was talking from the burning bush to Moses, Moses asked him, who shall I say has sent me? And God said, tell them, I am that I am sent you. Tell them, I am sent you. The word Jehovah, or the newer word Yahweh, is roughly a translation of the Jewish word for I am. So whenever Jesus in the New Testament said, I am, he was claiming to be God. I am the truth. I am the life. I am the way. Whatever I am you want to use. Christian scholars believe he was invoking the holy I am of God. And as a little point of interest on that, when Jesus was arrested in the garden, and Judas and the soldiers came up to him, Jesus said, well, who are you looking for? They said, we're looking for Jesus. And Jesus said, I am he. And I believe I heard one time that in the Greek, it just says, I am. And in the English translations, they added on the he to make it clearer. And at that point, they all fell over backwards. And I've heard said that the reason that happened is because at that point when he said, I am, he was releasing his divine power and invoking his name as God, and they fell over backwards. And it happened three times.
Who fell over backwards?
You did, Charlie.
Jesus was either, there were other times also where people picked up stones to stone him because he was blaspheming. And what blasphemy is claiming to be God. And actually at the end, the charge that the chief priests had against Jesus when they took him to be crucified was blasphemy because he did claim to be God. The only thing is, it's not blasphemy for him because he is God. Now to talk about Jesus' sacrifice. For remission of sins, there must be blood shed, which is why the Jews in the Old Testament did the animal sacrifices. But an animal, no matter how good of an animal it was, could not atone for a human life. So they had to do the sacrifices over and over and over, every day, every week, every month, every year, because it was not enough. But rather than have each of us give our life for our sins, which we discussed more before, would be justice, God sent his Son as the perfect sacrifice for all of us. Since he had no sin, he had no blemish, just as the sacrifice in the Old Testament had to be an animal with no blemish. Jesus gave his life willingly. He could have decided not to do it. And there was, that's been made clear in the Bible. But he willingly gave his life. Nobody took it from him. As he told Peter in the garden, if I wanted to fight, I could have legions of angels here at my command. And I'm sure those legions of angels were there, swords drawn, ready to go. He bore the sins, when he was on the cross, he bore the sins of all men for all time. When he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? At that point, the Father turned his back on him. He was no longer in the presence of God because he was bearing the sins. And any time where God isn't, that is a basic definition of hell. So that is where Jesus faced hell, in the fact that the Father turned his back on him. And all sins were on him at that point. And Jesus did die. He was dead. The Romans knew how to know if someone was dead or not. It was their job, the Roman soldiers. They had to know someone when they crucified him was actually dead. He was dead. He didn't swoon. He didn't do anything like that. He was completely and biologically deceased. But death couldn't hold him, because since he had no sin, he personally had no death penalty to pay. So just as easily as he laid his life down, he took it back up again and rose again on the third day. Now, a lot of people think this is a myth, myths, or a bunch of hogwash, or whatever you want to call it. But from the day of, over the last 2,000 years, many people have died. Many, many more people still believe. And I don't think that many people would die, especially 2,000 years later, for something that isn't the truth. What does it take to become a Christian? It's easy. Becoming a Christian is actually easy, and that's probably part of the problem. All you have to do is accept God's free gift. Just say, let me have it. There is nothing you can do to earn it. Because if you can earn it, then why did Jesus have to die? It wouldn't make sense. And basically, you know, you've all heard of when they have these big rallies and such, they have an altar call and all this. That's not necessary. All you would have to do is pray in your heart and ask Jesus into your life, and that's all it takes to become a Christian. Basically, it's just accepting God's free gift. What's going to happen after you do this? Your life will change from the inside out. The Apostle Paul says in Romans, behold, the old is gone, the new has come. You are a new creation. As Jesus tried to explain to Nicodemus in the book of John, we must be born again. That's where the born again part comes in. You're born again isn't a real good translation. A better translation is saying born anew. Because as Nicodemus said, how could I go again into my mother's womb? Which you can't do. But you're born anew from the inside out. When you are converted, the Holy Spirit comes to live in your, inside you. A lot of preachers say everybody has a God-shaped opening inside them. And whether you let God fill it or something else, that's going to be what runs your life. after accepting the gift, there's one thing that's always nice to do, and that is to get baptized. You see babies baptized, you see adults baptized. There's a lot of discussion among Christians, well, should we baptize infants who aren't able to accept the message themselves, or should we wait till they grow up? Or, you know, to me, just getting baptized is what's important. And what happens in baptism? Baptism is two things. First, it's a symbol that you are a Christian. Just as circumcision was a symbol in the Old Testament that you were a Jew, baptism is a symbol that you have been washed by Christ. It is a way of washing, it's a way towards the forgiveness of your sins. Now, we all associate Christians, well, a lot of people associate Christians with being good people who do nice things. Now, since I've said there's nothing you can do to earn your salvation, why are Christians usually such good people? A Christian doing good works is a reflection or a response of what God has given to them. Jesus told us a parable, one of his stories. There was a rich man, and he had many debtors. He called in one man who owed him millions and millions of dollars, and there was no way he could ever pay it back. But he had mercy on the man and forgave him his large debt. Then he called in another man who only owed him hundreds of dollars and had mercy on him and forgave his debt. Which man do you think was more grateful to the rich man? Well, of course, the one who received the bigger debt. Forgiveness. God has forgiven a great debt to all of us, a debt that we could, the only way we could pay would be with our life. And we no longer have to worry about that. It's been covered. So Christians are good not because they have to be, but because they want to be. The Apostle James, who is often quoted about works, said, Show me your faith without your works, and I, by my works, will show you my faith. So the works are a demonstration of the fact that a person is a Christian, and it's one of the best ways to tell if a person may be a Christian is by the way they behave. There's a song, I won't bother you with singing it, but I just want to read the verses off to you, and it touches on this. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord, and we pray that all unity may someday be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side, and we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk side by hand in hand, and will spread the good news throughout the land, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. Now, a lot of people also say, I don't want to join any church because they're all a bunch of hypocrites. They never do. They say, oh, we're supposed to do this and this and this. Oh, but they never do it. Let me remind you, we are even a Christian is still a sinner and will sin. We will never be perfect until we join the Lord in heaven after we leave this earth. But there's one thing I want you to remember. TGIF. Thank God I'm forgiven. And that's one of the things that keeps me going, because no matter what I do, God will always be willing to forgive me. Anyone can be a Christian. All you have to do is want to be. Anyone. You too can be a Christian. Before we go into questions, I want to qualify. I am not God. I do not claim to speak for God. I do not speak for God. So the questions are limited to the topic tonight of what is a Christian. And if you have a question for God, you could ask him yourself.
All right.
I'll recognize you as... All right. Tim Bolger right. has a question
for All right, let's sing it.
Thank you.
Paul, on a personal level, why did you become a Christian?
Yeah.
There was never any really point where I became a Christian because I was born into a Christian family. But there have been times where I've questioned it, and I, you know, over the years in my studies, I've questioned it and I fully accept it now.
And all right. Yes,
Goes back here. Since you quoted that you're a Christian, exactly what is your faith practice or belief? Are you Catholic? Are you Protestant?
Those are denominations.
Yes, but what are you?
I'm a Lutheran.
Okay.
I'm not really... Let me qualify. This is how I usually like saying it. I don't think any of the denominations get it completely right. I attend a Lutheran church because I feel, you know, what they give is close to what I feel the true beliefs are. But, you know, I try and stay, you know, if I could find a non-denominational church that I liked, I would probably be better off there.
Okay. Mike Lehman.
You know, what's wrong with atoning for sins? The heck with this being forgiven stuff? I mean, if you're going to go around and pollute the earth, murder, rape, pillage, steal, let's get some atonement handled.
Well, atonement
just saying I want forgiven by some being. Let's get atonement rolling.
The atonement was made by Jesus' sacrifice. He did that for all of us. So that we could be forgiven. So
I don't know if he covered everything.
Yes, he did.
Yes, Charlie.
Yeah, well, we had speakers here.
Here we go.
That said that the two versions of the Christmas that were inserted in scriptures, not one word or event described as accurate or true. Are you aware of the controversy regarding the story of Christmas?
I've heard some of them. You know, like...
I mean, or is this absolutely accurate?
I believe that whatever is in the Bible is 100% accurate and 100% the truth. I know there's discrepancies in where we put Christmas in the winter. And there's no way that Jesus was born in the winter because the shepherds wouldn't be out watching their flocks by night in the middle of the winter.
We keep follow up. The bleak winter. There's no historical evidence of this Herod going around and getting all the firstborn. There's no reference at all in any historical records. And there's no historical records at all of anything regarding Christmas to corroborate the versions.
Well, if I
the absence of the historical record, there's only one document.
Two. That I can't really speak to, but by faith I accept what God has given us in the Bible, and just because there's no proof that it was, doesn't mean that it wasn't. And one thing I did hear that was proven in the Christmas story is, remember in the book of Luke chapter 2, which is the famous, the one that Linus did in Charlie Brown Christmas? it says, well, Quirinius was governor of Syria. And they actually did find in an old record somewhere that there was a Quirinius who was governor of Syria.
That's all we've got that's true?
I didn't say that's all that's been proven. You can never prove a negative. The only way you can prove a negative logically is to be at all times and in all places, and then you would be God. But you can't prove a negative. Like I
it's
said,
not
just
a
be
negative. I'll leave it.
Just you because
got
there's
an assertion, that's not a negative.
Yeah. Just because
that's
there's
not a negative.
Okay.
It's an assertion.
Just because there's no proof that it happened, doesn't mean that it didn't happen.
Well, Charlie, I can. I'll answer your question in rebuttals.
I'll
take a stab at that, Charlie.
Now we gotta wait for the rebuttal.
You're gonna get it in the rebuttals, Charlie.
Animal blood.
I've been through this myself.
Well, what's the question? Can you hear the question?
Why do we have to shed blood to atone for our sins, especially innocent animals, for example? Yeah. Why would you do that?
The wages of sin is death, and when you die, when you give your life, it usually involves blood of some sort. And that was a rule that God made up with the Jews even thousands of years before Christ came. And as I said, the animal sacrifices were more symbolic than actual anything, because an animal couldn't atone for a human. And whereas when Jesus came and shed his blood for all of us as the perfect ultimate sacrifice, that covered all of us for all time.
All right. And Peter.
So are Mormons Christians?
Yeah. To my knowledge of the Mormon, I don't really want to answer the question more than saying, to my knowledge, from what I've heard given by others, that Mormons would, according to the description I gave here, Mormons would not be considered Christians. And I really don't want to go into it that deeply because I really don't know that much about it. The only thing I could say that I've heard about it is the Mormon faith believes that all people will eventually become gods. You grow in status and status. I don't know if reincarnation is involved or what, until you basically believe in multiple gods, whereas the Christians and the Jews believe there's only one God. And that's what I've been told. And if that's incorrect, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Yeah, Paul, in your faith, you mentioned heaven. I guess people would die and go to heaven for eternity. How about, you talked about hell, but is that clear? You feel that people would go to hell for eternity?
If you haven't accepted God's free gift, yes. And in the Old Testament, see, a lot of people wonder, well, what about in the Old Testament? In the Old Testament, before Jesus came and made the sacrifice, they believed that the sacrifice was coming. They believed the Messiah. They believed God was going to take care of things. And that belief is what saved people in the Old Testament. Whereas now that the sacrifice has been given, we need to accept that sacrifice.
Thank you.
All right. Yes, Mike?
You know, I saw something disturbing on the internet where they compared the Quran to the Bible. And the Bible seems much more violent and negative and unforgiving and un-Christ-like and they compared murders and death and blood and less forgiveness. And it was very disturbing to see that side by side, the Bible being shed in that light. I thought, do you have any comment on that?
I'm unfamiliar with the Quran.
I've never read the Bible, but
yeah, I've never read the Quran, so I can't speak about that. But I can tell you about what you're talking about, what's in the Bible. Mm-hmm. Number one, the Bible is history. The history of the Old Testament is the history of the Jewish people up through the time of Christ. And as that, you know, them being sinners and imperfect, it's showing a lot of their sins. And it's showing how God blesses them when they're not sinning, and God punishes them when they are sinning. And if you want an example, look at all you need to go no further than King David. King David, who is renowned by the Christians and the Jews as one of the greatest kings, one of the greatest believers of all mankind, he was an adulterer and a murderer. But he confessed his sin, and God forgave him. Also, people talk about ethnic cleansing in the Bible. Weren't the Jews guilty of genocide? In a Christian viewpoint, I've been told, any government is a tool of God's for enforcement of his law, be it a Christian country or a non-Christian country, anyone. And a lot of what the Jews did, especially during when they first came back to the Promised Land, to Canaan, you may call it ethnic cleansing, but they were doing God's will by eliminating the sin from the land. And this is what I was told.
It's an ill wind that blows nobody good. All right. The sin from the land. Charles, and then Tim.
Right.
Yeah, you... I keep saying that scriptures are history. And we had a speaker here who said the scriptures were in fact folklore and poetry. The Bible was folklore and poetry. Now, in terms of being a historical history, there's 800 years between the alleged events of Moses and when they were first written down. And I'm just wondering how valid a history that could be. That's 8 centuries. And there's centuries between the alleged existence of Jesus and the first written account. The oldest scrap, and I'm a librarian of the New Testament, any library in the world, is 320 years after he allegedly lived.
The oldest that's been found. Just because it hasn't been found
in any library right now is 320 years after he allegedly lived. Now, the question is, where's the historical accuracy there?
Well, like I said, just because, again, what's been found, I mean, a lot of texts and such, ancient texts and such, we'll never find. And I personally would believe that much of the New Testament was written by the end of the first century. And I base this on is most of the Old Testament is Paul's letters. The word epistle means letter. And all those books with the names of the cities, the Ephesians, the Corinthians, the Galatians, etc., were letters written by the Apostle Paul to the different churches he founded. So if they were letters, they were written down.
After Jesus was dead.
But less than 100 years after, less than 50 years after Jesus was dead.
Well, somebody's going to write about me 50 years from now.
Why would they want
to? Why would they want to write about you?
You're not.
I don't know. I don't know when they were written, but my faith says that whenever things were written down, it was with God's guidance, and God doesn't forget.
Paul Rescino, that sounds. Yes. Peter?
You mentioned that part of this depends on this Trinity concept.
Yes.
Now, you're aware that, let's say, Eastern churches, like Catholic Church, they're monophysites, where they don't have a Trinity. Did you know that? The Eastern churches?
some
I don't
Eastern
know
churches.
Much about the Eastern churches.
Now, the Trinity idea, wasn't it arrived at in the year 325?
I don't know.
The Council of Nicaea, where they hammered it out?
I'm not sure. Church history in those ways, I haven't studied that much. I'm just going by what I've been taught overwhelmingly, time and time again, by many different sources.
Yeah, they put the creed together.
There's different branches. The old one is like Catholic.
I understand that.
Much older than Lutheranism. They're called monophysites, and they don't have a Trinity. They have more like a unity. It's all in one. So I can't explain it.
And again, you know, I don't even really think that's really a critical fighting point in that they believe, my point was that you believe in God, not that you believe that God is the Trinity. Because none of us can really understand what God is. Think about this. You have an ant crawling on the ground. This ant knows there's people. But our world is so much bigger than his world, he couldn't understand us if he tried. And that's the same relationship with us to God. We're just so small and finite compared to this infinite God that there's no way we can truly understand.
All right, I've got a question for you.
Okay.
Okay, all right, Brahm.
Personally, I think that Christian traditions sometimes have been a little sick and the perpetual virginity of Jesus' mother is one of the legends that has no justification in Scripture that I can see. In fact, Mary tells the child Jesus, the 12-year-old child Jesus, how can you do this to when he's stayed behind in Jerusalem, and gotten lost as far as they were concerned? How can you do this to us, your father and me, referring to Joseph? So if Mary refers to Jesus as Joseph as Jesus' father, and others do too, why would you think that she did not know a human father?
Before Jesus, she didn't. Afterwards, she must have, because Jesus has brothers and sisters.
Yes, well, why not
the what you're talking about is that the, you know,
they were
there's things like the Immaculate Conception and such that are part of the Catholic tradition, but then that's getting into denominational, and I'm talking about generic Christian. And if it's not in the Bible, I, like you, don't think it happened. And it's not.
Okay.
No, it's not the Immaculate Conception. It's the virgin birth you're talking about.
Yeah,
Immaculate Conception.
Well, he's talking about that she remained a virgin even after.
It's called the virgin birth. Immaculate Conception refers to her conception.
I'm not right. I understand. I'm just... maybe I got it wrong, but I'm not familiar with the Catholic theology.
Yes, can I elaborate on that? Yeah,
Paul Johnson.
Yeah, perpetual virginity. Never mind.
Go ahead. Let's hear it.
Well, yeah, the doctrine of perpetual virginity is a Catholic notion. We Lutherans and other Protestants do not buy that.
It's not in the Bible.
Right, because we're in the one scene in the temple where they, you know, where the Jews question him, aren't your brothers right here with us? You know, Joseph, James, I forget the other two names, Jude, and your sisters, Aren't they here with us? The Catholic tradition claims that these are, you know, these were actually Jesus' cousins. We, you know, we Lutherans and other Protestants accept them as his half-brothers and sisters, the children of Joseph and Mary.
And no. To all that, again, I want to say, I can say this.
No, we take it our faith.
If Mary was special somehow, other than the fact of being chosen by God to carry his son to birth, if she was special, and the angel, when he made the announcement to Mary, he said, "Blessed are you among women, not above women." She's a woman, like any other. And if Mary were special, I've known Catholics who consider Mary God the Mother. And if you have God giving birth to God, how is that special? The specialness of it is Jesus was born of a woman, an ordinary woman. And that's what makes it special.
Yes, born of a woman. Yes. Mike?
I like your aunt's analogy, and then I've heard Charlie talk about initial cause of God. What's your best what is your best proof that of a God?
A lot of people say, I can't see God, so he mustn't exist. But you can't see the wind.
Yes.
But you can still feel its effect. And in my life, I have felt God touch me, strengthen me. He's right here, right now, holding me up and giving me words to speak through his Spirit. And without that, I probably never would have gotten up here to give this presentation. I've been literally working on this presentation, or should I say more, working on the nerve to get up here and give it, for 5 years. Because I had to make sure I was physically, mentally, and spiritually in the right spot to give it.
Did God help you get up here?
Yes.
Yeah.
I've been in prayer for weeks about
God's
doing this.
God's been helping all of us. So, all right. Charles, asking.
We know that.
It said that among political scientists say that 500,000 years from now, Paul, the one thing the United States is going to be noted for is the separation of church and state. That we kept religion completely, totally, and absolutely from having any influence or effect on public policy. What are your feelings regarding that concept of putting religion outside of our day-to-day operation?
Okay, now we're getting into
it. Do you like the theocracy?
The actual separation of church and state is not in the Constitution anywhere.
It isn't.
It is.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
No.
It's the First Amendment.
No.
It's the first thing
it says. No. It says the government shall establish, shall take no action to establish a religion, roughly. It doesn't say, quote, separation of church and state. Separation of church and state comes from a letter written by Thomas Jefferson to an associate of his, and it's somewhat of a misquote, because in the letter he was talking to, I forget who it was, but he was a religious person, and he was worried that that clause in the Constitution would cause problems for the churches. And Thomas Jefferson's response was, to do that, there would have to be a wall of separation of church and state. It was not the intention of our founders to take religion out of life. It was so that the government would not, the establishment clause, that's it. So the government would not establish a state religion like they had in England, that good old King Henry VIII started.
they have state religions, not even a national religion.
National religion, yes. But that was the intent of the Establishment Clause, that the government would not establish a religion as the religion of the United States. Not that we would keep religion out of our daily life. Thomas Jefferson knew the value of the morality, we'll say, because Jefferson was a deist and had nothing to do with God or anything like that. When Jefferson was president, he went to church on Sundays because he felt so strongly that the morality that they taught in church was important, that he felt that as president, it was a good idea for him to set a good example.
Have you ever seen Jefferson's Bible?
Jefferson's Bible.
Jefferson probably didn't have a Bible.
Yes,
you don't know that.
Wrote
one.
It's a Bible.
The Smithsonian.
It's a deist Bible.
He crossed
the metal library.
It out.
or some say even cut it out with
yes,
a knife.
He did.
Any reference to anything. To anything supernatural,
as
alleged.
Yes. As I said when I was talking about translations and such, since he didn't do it as with the intention of making a true representation of what God wanted, since he didn't believe in God, I wouldn't accept his Bible as a true scripture.
That's the work of the devil.
He crossed half of it out.
Okay, Brown, may I address Charlie's question on evidence for Christianity?
This is not good.
Would you mind if I help?
You can ask him a question.
You can do it in a rebuttal.
I'll do it in a rebuttal.
Okay. Period is for.
Okay.
What does the church say?
All right.
Paul,
what is probably the one biggest thing that God has shown you in your life recently? The greatest evidence in your own life that God brought, that you were able to feel God's presence, or where he had specifically come in and really helped you out?
I have two things I want to say to that. About 15 years ago, I had lost a job. I was really feeling down. And
it's okay, just take your time.
The prophet Elijah, at one point, he got very discouraged and depressed. The whole world was after him. And he prayed to God to take his life, but God wouldn't do it. He restored it. I went through the same thing. I prayed to God, please, just take me away. And that was one of the first points where I very strongly felt God reach down and touch me and restore me. Over the last several years, I have been working more and more on faith and trust and letting God lead my life. And, you know, there's an old saying, let go, let God. And it's funny where they thought that came from, because they thought that some college student had let God individual letters on pieces of paper, and the D would flap down and up and flap down and up, and it would go, let go, let God, let go. I thought that was interesting. But I'm trying to let God control my life more and more and more, and I find that I'm calmer, I find that I'm less stressed out, and I find that, you know, in the long run, it may not be the way I want it, but things usually work out for the best.
Yes. Okay. All right, Doug.
Yeah, I went back to your presentation, you know, about becoming a Christian. You have this line in there about feeling a change from the inside. And I wrote a little question out here. This is a hypothetical one in fiction. Do you think Scrooge became a Christian in the Christmas Carol? Because there was a definite change in him from the way he went to bed and the way he was in the next morning, all happy and giddy and whatever.
It's a possibility, because that's the kind of transformation you would have, and maybe not that dramatic, that outspoken, but it's the kind of transformation you would have. And he could have been a Christian before that, just not a very good one.
Rock one like me. Yes. Eric, come on. Some of you were not bold enough to ask a question. Animating you. All right, go ahead, Charles.
Yeah, religion isn't terribly popular among some people in the United States right now, due to the fact it's the cause of a lot of anxiety and acts of violence created by one of the sister religions. You're all Abrahamic religions, if I'm correct. And I'm somewhat concerned as well that you said that God had some sort of guard composed of angels with swords, and he could have told them to slay people or something like this.
No, I was just
referring. Religion is causing us in this country, from a secular point of view, a lot of problems right now. Religion in general.
And I'll say just the opposite. I see the lack of religion, the pulling of religion out of public life, out of the schools, out of everything, is what's causing the problems, not the other way around. It's a matter of opinion. There's no way you can say.
You're telling me religion's not causing any problems in the United States?
What problems is religion causing?
You didn't hear what happened in California last week?
That's not Christianity. That's something else.
That's
religion.
I'm not talking about religion in general. I'm talking about Christianity.
All right.
Okay, let's talk turkey. What about David Koresh from the Branch Davidian cult?
It's a different thing.
I don't know enough about that.
Okay.
The sources I've heard say that he was a Christian and it was terrible what the American government did to him. And if you look at closely at what they did do, it was pretty terrible. Going after people who were not violent, I don't even know if they were armed at all, with flame-throwing tanks. Now that's interesting.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, would you say that this day and age, most people are not religious, they're not church-going, but would you say they're becoming more spiritual rather than religious? Would you say that's a trend going around the country, or most parts of the world, Europe, the United States?
I'm not sure on that either. To me,
They're not denominational. People are getting away from the churches. They're tired of it.
Nowhere in the Bible does it say you must go to church.
No.
The Ten Commandments say remember the Sabbath day, but the definition of that to the Jews was more, you know, the day of rest kind of thing. And also going to temple.
But it was certainly Jesus' habit to go on the Sabbath to shul, to synagogue, and it was also his family's custom to go to the temple on the high holy days, if they could make it. Right. Okay.
Yeah, you mentioned the Ten Commandments. We had a guy here that revised them all, and he actually added 10 new ones. I'm curious, as a guide, you were saying Jefferson said religion was a good guide to morality. Why isn't there a commandment I've often been confused that says, thou shalt not have a slave? Or how about one that says, thou shalt not torture? Was this an oversight? I mean, they got some strange ones, like covet thy neighbor's goods. You know what? It's really not like high on my list, you know?
of evil things to do, Paul.
Two things I need to say on that. As far as torture would be concerned, the way I learned the Ten Commandments, you know, saying thou shalt not kill covers a lot of different things, not just taking someone's life. And torture would be included under there, because you're not torturing someone because you like them. And what was your other...
Well, thou shalt not have a slave. Or is that a subject to interpretation?
That's a good point, but another thing I could say in all this is, as a Christian, the Christian belief state, that we are no longer under the law that was given in the book of Exodus, because Jesus,
until all is fulfilled,
he fulfilled it all. So the law is there to show us that we're not nice people. And the law was more than the Ten Commandments. There's chapters and chapters and chapters and chapters.
You mean the 600 laws in the Old Testament?
613.
Count them all. You're supposed to follow all those?
Yes. No.
Yes.
Yes, yes, and no. We are supposed to follow them. We cannot. We are not able to follow them.
At last we have somebody
and
else.
And since Jesus died to forgive our sins, it is not necessary.
Who makes the decision which law is to be followed and which law is not? God gave us all these laws. He didn't say you could choose. It's like a cafeteria. Go in and choose the top 10.
Did he not? You don't have to follow the Ten Commandments.
All right.
I didn't say that.
That's cool.
Repeat what you just said about these laws.
We're supposed to follow them.
And?
But we do not have the ability to follow them perfectly. We can't.
You try to follow all those laws.
Yes.
All of them. Did you ever eat cheeseburgers?
No.
No. Come on. Do you ever eat cheeseburgers?
No.
You don't. Very good. That's great. Do you ever eat shellfish?
Yes.
What's the difference?
Okay. We're straying off the subject, but I can talk about it.
We strayed off the subject a long time ago. It's like you either accept all the laws or you don't. You can't pick and choose, is my point.
In the New Testament, Peter, who was one of the original 12 apostles, who started slipping back into Judaism, their customs, refused to go, and God wanted him to go visit a Gentile. And Peter wouldn't go because he didn't want to eat what was considered unclean food from the law. But God told him through a dream, basically, that what I have made clean through the sacrifice of his son, how can you say it is unclean?
So all the laws dealing with food are thrown away. How many laws are there like that?
Yes.
How about the other laws about what you're to wear? Stoning a person who, is sleeping with another man. How about a man who sleeps with a man? Should he be stoned? If you're picking and choosing laws here, and I'm a little bit disturbed by it, because you're saying the Bible is truth, but then you're pulling back and saying, hey, wait a minute, I get to choose which ones are okay, which ones aren't. Do you really believe, or are you just being a very convenient person, which is something I'll address after Tim gets up?
Okay.
Maybe.
I appreciate your point. I understand what you're saying.
That's all I want to say.
I wish I had an answer for you.
That's a great answer.
All I can say...
He's trying. He is.
I'm not a theologian. I have no training. Okay? I'm just a caring person. And what I have been taught on that type of subject is, when Jesus came and died, we are no longer bound by the law. Okay. We still need to do God's will for us.
All right. How are we doing on time?
Right now it's 7:44. It seems like we got a lot of people chomping at the bit to go up for rebuttals. I'd like to get everybody about 6 minutes.
Charlie's got to ask his sixth question of the night.
Perhaps okay. last question then.
All right.
We got one chance, Charlie. I'm talking back for you.
Right.
How about miracles? Do miracles occur as a result of faith?
Miracles can result as an act of faith. Miracles can occur at any time.
They do.
They do. They have. God could use a miracle on a non-believer to try and wake them up.
Have you ever seen a miracle personally?
No.
I hope that I made it clear to those of you who are a little new to the college that you are entitled to ask a question in the question period and to give a rebuttal in the rebuttal period which follows. Okay? All right. So?
I have one thing I'd like to say before we go into the rebuttals. I would like to challenge any, if there are any other than me and Tim Christians here, to come up and give your testimony.
Whoa.
Give what?
That's testimony.
Well,
yeah. Why are you a believer?
Why?
Or why did you become, how did you become a believer?
Why about a non-believer?
Tim, you're going to have to tell us how much time we have.
It's right now.
How many here have some testimony to give,
rebuttal.
Some rebuttal to make, some news okay. to impart, whatever is right. on your heart to deliver to the rest of us.
Okay. It's now 7:44. All right. It's now 7:44. I think.
Right. How many here are holding up their hands? They're going to say something. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, you might be moved by something that somebody here says, some ignorant remark. Okay. Like
it's
I
about 8 minutes apiece.
You know,
no, about six.
All right.
Okay. I'll go first.
All right.
We want testimony.
Well, I'm going to give you one, Charlie, because right around my sophomore year of college, I had that classic born-again experience. I actually got on my knees in my dorm room and said, okay, God, come fill my life, and I admit I'm a sinner, and then something happened and changed. I couldn't quite figure out what, but I do know that there was a visible, what I call, crisis of conscience and a lot more awareness of what I was doing wrong, and then a desire to get to church and learn. The first thing that I was confronted with after becoming a Christian was, okay, does this make any sense? Because my best friend used to tell me, Tim, it's an easy answer you're looking for. I said, no, this is real. And all of a sudden, I had to start digging into the science of Christian apologetics. Is there a God? Does he make sense? Is there evidence that could be proven in a court of law that the claims that Christ made are good? I was led to read a book by Josh McDowell that said evidence demands a verdict. He also wrote another book that called More Evidence That Demands a Verdict, and then More Evidence That Demands a Verdict. So he wrote three treatises on the whole claims of Christ, the prophecy problems that were in there, the background in historical archaeological evidence, and many of the other types of things. But I think the most powerful thing that happened to me was seeing some friends of mine with their lives absolutely being changed over time and over the long haul. I don't want to get involved with it here, but yes, I do know somebody who was at a place called Christian Assembly Church in Peoria who swears up and down that God healed her of a cancer virus, and she was up and around 20 years after it had happened.
I'm not going to discount the presence of miracles, but if you're going to prove that you have a miracle, look, you've got medical evidence to back it up. She said she had it. I also know, too, that my walk with God was, for the first 10 or 15 years of my life, was a rather straggly one. I would go to a bar or a party on a Saturday night, and I would be stumbling in the church on a Sunday. I would be the biggest hypocrite, probably, of which I am chief. And it probably wasn't until maybe 10 or 12 years ago that I really started getting more into the Christian faith. What I'm finding now is that the more I walk with God, I mean, you know, pray and learn about the scripture, learn about God, my life becomes a lot more at peace. And I can particularly tell you at Christmas time especially, because I have one of these jobs where, you know, I sell consumer electronics on eBay and Amazon, and we get a lot of customer complaints. I'm the guy who gets a call when when UPS delivers a broken television set, so I feel the full wrath and of all our customers and everything else. And the one thing you want to do is lash out and get mad at these guys and realize some things. And what I've been finding is that the more I've been leaning on my faith, the more patient I've been, the more caring I've been, I'm not getting so much aggravation. There's a real peace that's coming in through me. And that's probably the most practical benefits that I have seen in my Christian faith. I'm not going to say that other witches won't produce the same results, but I do know the one unique thing about the Christian religion is you don't have to strive for inner peace or something else. When you accept Christ, the work is done. That does not mean that you do not strive to become a better person, because what happens is you're always going to know, yes, there's more to do it. St. Peter calls it, howbeit that I do, that I do not, that the very thing I do I hate, that I do, for it is not me that does it, but Christ that dwelleth, that sin that dwelleth in me. It is a classic, what we call crisis of faith, or the conflict between sin and what you know is right. The point is, I think as a Christian, you have in you the will and the consciousness and awareness of what God is and what is required to do it. I mean, you don't measure up. Now, as far as faith is concerned, if you're a Christian, you need good works. I mean, it says in James, faith without works is dead, meaning that there'll be fruits to your labors. If you're truly a believer, you're going to want to do good works. You're going to want to do good. You're going to want to make sure that you follow God's will. And it'll almost become to an imperative in your own life. I also know, too, that when it comes to the evidence that comes with God, I think the one final argument that put the nail in the coffin for me was a gentleman by the name of Ivan Panin in the 1880s, who was a doctorate in mathematics from Russia, who actually took the original Greek and Hebrew number systems in the Bible and did a certain sentence, did some probabilistic analysis on it, and said if St. Paul had all the mathematical tools, it would have taken him 300 years to construct this paragraph of scripture. He found the same pattern consistent from Genesis to Revelation. If you want to Google it, just Google Letter to the Philadelphia Sun, Ivan Panin, P-A-N-I-N. You can find it anywhere on the web. You'll find it in some good scriptural accounts of the actual biography of what he did. The other guy I really have to admire was C.S. Lewis, the college professor who became a Christian late in life and wrote some of the most apologetic novels around, including Mere Christianity, The Screwtape Letters, and a number of others. Another one I like is the megachurch pastor here at Willow Creek, Lee Strobel, who also did a six-minute, and who also wrote an apologetic sentence. But now I'm out of time. Charlie, you cannot be further from the truth. The claims of Christ and Christianity are scientifically proven, and I will be more than happy to show you the evidence. But you have to be open and have a good open mind for scientific inquiry. I've never said, yes, I believe that Christianity can be proven by science. The claims of God, not God himself, but the claims that he makes can be proven via prima facie evidence. And I can and will show you the sources. I'm not saying it does take an element of faith to believe in God. it does take an element there. But enough.
You're in 7 minutes.
Okay.
So the rest of us get 7 minutes.
Oh, yeah. All right.
I don't know why you got it. I
want it. Okay. You want to make it seven? We'll make it seven then.
Seven, yeah.
All right. I violated the first rule.
Scientific evidence.
We do, Charlie.
Yeah, why are you using science to establish truth?
Because of the scientific method invented by Christians, because Charlie. That's why.
This is coming off of next week. Next week, when you show up here, this is coming off your time, by the way.
That's fine.
Great. Thank you, Paulie. Paulie, thank you so much for that. That was a. It was a personal, what did you call it, a testimonial, of your beliefs. I'm going to take off and say I have a real problem with it from the very top. It is not easy to be a Christian, and I believe in God, and I think a lot of Christians think I am a Christian. I do not believe I am a Christian. There is no evidence that I could accept scientifically to say that God exists. God is beyond the scientific method. And I'm sorry, don't agree with you there.
I know.
For me, God is a mystery. And as God is expressed in Judaism or Islam or through Buddha or through nativist religions, that there is a mystery there that I cannot define. And that in itself defines God. It is a negative, as we said earlier, that cannot be defined. So the original question here was, why am I a Christian? And I think that that goes more to something that I was interested in. I don't come every night, but I came tonight because I was bored and because I wanted to hear something interesting. And I think that we beat about a lot of scripture, and I think that there are going to be people who follow me who talk about how the church lost its way during the Council of Nicaea, how different belief systems were forced into one by politicians. And I think that there is a great point to be learned from that, that this was a revolutionary concept that was perverted by politicians for their political means. So today, speaking from the early 21st century, I have to look back only upon my own life and take that into consideration and take into consideration what I know on a very limited basis about Judaism, or what I know on a very limited basis about Islam, or even about other Christian beliefs. We're talking about Eastern beliefs, or the Coptic religion, and we're talking about Orthodox beliefs, and they are different. And there have been battles during the time of history that we know, from the Council of Nicaea forward, about what is this definition. I don't care. It is, what is this definition to me? To me, it is, you might call it a humanist belief, but a golden rule belief that you will not do unto others as you would not have them do unto you. And that is stated in many different ways by the axial religions. And I believe, as you said, it's very easy to call yourself a Christian. And there are people who get up every night and proclaim that they want to leave this country and they're good Christians. And I wonder where they're coming from. However, I think it is hard to put that experience, whether it is from an actual religion such as Judaism, or a late actual religion such as Christianity or Islam, into practice. People kill and they say, this is my religion that I am killing for. And that is exactly, I believe, what these prophets or people, and no, that's one of the reasons I am not a Christian, is I cannot say Jesus is God, that these people came forward with these ideas. Enough.
Okay.
Thank you. All right, next.
I guess
it's an open mic, and
it's
Preach to us, baby. Preach. Come okay. on. Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. Amen, brother.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
As most of you know, I'm Doug. Yeah, I gave a talk about a year ago, about this time, on, you know, why Jesus came to us, Mary, men and ladies. And, you know, a question I raised at the time was, who do you say I am? but at any rate, I touched a little bit on that tonight. I think the speaker covered a lot of ground. I just want to make some editorial notes. In regards to Jesus coming, you know, in the opening beliefs, he said Jesus died as a perfect sacrifice and rose again on the third day, which is true. But also I added here, it's not totally true, in that, and I'm a Catholic, by the way, died in the wool Catholic. I spent 2 years at a Franciscan seminary after high school.
Can you show us the bruises?
No, there's no bruises. But anyway, we did sing that hymn, though. They'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. They'll know we are Christians by our love. I remember some of the words. I was sort of singing along with him because I know how the music goes. But Jesus basically was the Word of God made flesh. In other words, until we, you know, the Jews had an idea of how to lead a moral life, but they didn't know exactly the exact rules. So I think Jesus is God's messenger to us, telling us exactly how to lead our lives. You know, if you read Matthew, you know, they had that play God spell, and they quoted a lot from Matthew. One of the things, you know, regards to being, you know, they did a lot of the prodigal son. The son went away and did a lot of bad things, and then he came back, and then the father welcomed him, even though he was a terrible sinner. And the brother was very jealous and said, "Why are you treating him like that?" And the father says, "Well, that son of mine that went away, and we thought he was dead, came back, and we're all glad, and they killed the fatted calf." And so at any rate, you know, for you who are not believers, one of the things I've said in the past, that even you humanists can get a foothold in heaven even though you're not baptized or committed to Christianity, in the sense that you may be doing some of the things that Matthew mentions in his gospel. I think it's chapter 25. I don't have my Bible with me. But it's the case of, you know, and they mention this in Godspell too, where, you know, the God is there, the judge of all humankind, and he has before him the sheep and the goats. I don't know if you remember that scene. But the moral of the story is the sheep took care of the least of the brethren. In other words, the person that showed up at the doorstep naked, the person, they gave him clothing, the person that showed up hungry, you gave him something to eat, the person that showed up homeless, you gave him shelter. I think these things will count in the judgment. I really believe that we die with our consciences of what we tried to do during our lives, you know, whether we're committed Christians or not. And so at any rate, you know, if you didn't do any of these things, you know, even though you're a baptized Christian, and I come to you and say, you know, I need a place to stay for the night, I'm hungry, can you give me a meal? And you say, well, go away, don't bother me, you know, go somewhere else. I think that's a negative. It'll count against you in the final judgment when you die. All of us will die at some point, and according to Scripture, you know, there will be a judgment. The other thing I wanted to point out was that Christianity, basically, you know, he pointed out early that the early Christians were martyrs for the most part because the Romans did not recognize them as a religion. Actually, Christianity took off under the reign of the Emperor Constantinople. I heard someone mentioning, I was out for a little bit there, about the Council of Nicaea. That took place in 325 AD, and it was under the Roman Emperor Constantine, who had successes for using the cross in his battles against a rival that united the Roman Empire under him. So he became and his mother was a Christian, so he became a big promoter of Christianity. In fact, he ruled, presided over the Nicene Council, which dealt with the heresy of Arianism, which stated that
Jesus was just God and not man. And for those of you that do go to church, you know, in our Catholic churches, every Sunday we say the Nicene Creed, and we say, true God, true man, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father. Now we say consubstantial with the Father, of the same substance. So all that was ironed out in the Nicene Creed, and it's been used forward in time to this very day. Yeah. The other thing that Jesus did, you know, we talk about the Ten Commandments. Now, Jesus in the Scripture says that he summed up the commandments when questioned in two of them. He called them, what are, they asked, the Pharisees, I guess, asked them, what are the two greatest commandments? And the way Jesus answered them, he said, first, love God with your whole heart, your whole soul, and your whole mind. And then love your neighbor as yourself. And then he said, if you think about it, he summed up that the rest of the commandments are contained within these two commandments, which I think personally is true. The other thing regards to baptism, I don't know if any of you are aware of that. In the Catholic Church, we have something that brings people into our church that starts out in Lent and climaxes at the Easter Vigil. It's called the RCI program. That stands for Rid of Christian Initiation of Adults, so that, you know, there's three sacraments that we address: baptism, Eucharist, and confirmation in this program. And so you go through instruction, depending on where you are in your faith, for receiving the sacraments. And then over time, you make commitments, and then, you know, you get a sponsor, and you go to instruction, and then at Easter, in the vigil, you receive these sacraments, and you become an official member of the Catholic Church. And I think there may be something similar in the other Christian denominations. So, at any rate, you know, the thing is that just claiming that you're a Christian is no guarantee that you are going to get into heaven. Good works were mentioned. I think good works are demanded, and also forgiveness. You know, in the Our Father, we say, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And so, unless we are willing to be forgiving in our own lives, we are not going to get forgiveness from God for our sins. Amen.
All right. Okay.
All right, Doug.
Bill Wentz.
I'm going to be a bit eclectic, and I hope that doesn't mean too terribly disorganized, but some of my points came to my mind that might clarify a few problems that people are having tonight. One of the things I got out of my first year of college in engineering school. I had a humanities professor who explained the difference between eisegesis and exegesis. Now, eisegesis is putting your own presumptions into an argument, into a belief problem. And I think that some people have a way of doing it in a whole bunch of situations, a whole bunch of subjects. And this exegesis, which is to understand what the author intended with a certain word, whether that be the Bible, and I will come with, I'd like to do exegesis of the Constitution. I think this idea of the courts, the Constitution is what the judges say is, I think that's an exegesis of the Constitution. This idea of a state church and foreign public schools. Years ago, I read Madison's Moral and Remonstrance Against Religious Assessments, which was a proposal of the Virginia legislature to have tax money support the Church of England.
Excuse me.
And what he describes, how he describes an established church, has long seemed to me, well, basically what we get from the public schools. It's sort of, I even get kind of a the public schools say, without an education, you're not going to do anything in life, which is a sort of hell in a way. The idea of preserving the Bible, you can't say this, it's true. The Catholic Church has long had the idea that sacred tradition, and that's supported even in the Bible, towards the end of the Gospel of John, says there's so many things he did that you wouldn't have the paper write it all on. So there can be non-biblical truth. And the Catholic Church, I should have asked a question about what our speaker thinks of the claims of the Catholic Church. One, that the Bible is a Catholic book, and two, that it was founded by Jesus Christ. So, there's also a book that I think is worth checking out. It's called The Gospel According to Penis, which came out about 50 years ago. There's a couple things in there. There's a passage from Søren Kierkegaard that everybody has a religion. It's whatever is most important. Desire in life, well, that's what your religion is. And there's another comment that you can't prove that God exists because you wouldn't be putting your faith in God if it were proven. You'd be putting your faith in the evidence that there's a God. So, I'll leave it at that.
Okay. All right, next, we got an open mic.
Okay.
All right, Brahm.
I'm a believer.
7 minutes, you know, Brahm.
I think it's in Alice Through the Looking Glass, or that they say that in the morning you recite 13 beliefs that are impossible, you know, in the Apostles' Creed or the Nicene Creed. Well, I can say, thank God, I can say the Apostles' Creed or the Nicene Creed and accept the words of those creeds. And even the Athanasian Creed, I think, though it becomes a little perplexing at points. But I don't think people are usually saved by reciting them. And a lot of people are saying things in church which they give credit to, but they don't know what they're saying. It doesn't mean much to them. I believe that Jesus was born of a virgin, that is, his mother was a young woman, hadn't had a child yet. And she was married to Joseph. They were betrothed. It wasn't illegal for him to have her. It was improvident because he was broke. And it was not good for him to take her home when the family wasn't in the best of circumstances. And maybe there wasn't much room, and maybe his sister was getting married, and maybe all sorts of things. You know, it's not always convenient to get married. But I think they had. And he takes his bride-to-be to Bethlehem. Why? Because he's a pious Jew who believes in the promise to David his ancestor. He believes David is his ancestor. And we get two genealogies which don't agree, one in Matthew and one in Luke, to say that Joseph is his father, and he both of them say the father of Joseph was, you know, and then the son of Joseph. So if you don't believe the genealogies, and I don't, they're written for to say truths. They're not necessarily absolutely accurate historically. I don't care whether they're, you know, they are there to convey truths about, you know, he was the descendant of that woman who kept the house in Jericho. We don't think that it was all that healthy a house. There may have been things going on in that house that were not too kosher, okay? And one of his ancestors was Ruth, a Moabitess woman. Moabites were non-believing people.
Moabites.
And in fact, they were to be excluded to the 10th generation from Israel if they married in and so on. But she was the grandmother of King David, right? And then there was Tamar, you know, the three women who are named in that genealogy. Who was Tamar? She had a son by her
father.
Jacob.
No.
Yes.
Judah.
But Judah.
Your father-in-law.
Yeah, you're right. And Judah was the, you know, the ancestor of those who call themselves Jews. Well, does it mean anything? Yes, yes, it all means something. And it means that Jesus was human. It means that he was human, like you and me, born of a woman, Paul says. Born under the law of an observant Jew. Does that mean that if you believe in the law, or in, that you do everything just by the law? Jesus wants you to. Jesus asks. He wants us to be holy and perfect. That's what is commanded in the law. Oh, it's time. All right. But there is forgiveness with God. God loves us. Life loves us.
All right,
and life gives meaning to everything. Creator.
All right.
All right. This guy wants to get up there.
Thank you, Dr. Ben.
First of all, I speak here practicing Reformed Jew. There were a number of comments that were made earlier about the 613 mitzvot. Reformed Judaism teaches that, yes, God gave us free will,
And that, yes, we're entitled to pick and choose. So, pass the cheese and sausage pizza, please. Second, there was some talk about Thomas Jefferson.
Maybe in the house.
Thomas Jefferson was a deist. What that means is that, yes, he believed in God. But deists believe that God is kind of like a master clockmaker. Once he gets the universe set up and gets it so that it works, it functions according to his natural laws, that's kind of it. God's finished his responsibilities, and that the rest is, again, up to us. Third, there was also some talk tonight about monophysitism. Now, monophysitism has nothing to do with the Trinity at all. All Christians, unless that they're Seventh-day Adventists, which the monophysitists are not, believe in the Trinity. Basically, most versions of Christianity is practiced in the West, and is practiced by the Eastern Orthodox churches, believe in biphysitism. That teaches that God had two natures, one human, one divine. Monophysitism teaches that God had one nature, divine, and that he wasn't human. That Jesus had two natures, one human, one divine, and monophysitism teaches that Jesus had one nature, and that was divine, that he wasn't human. And this was a great source of division between the church, or between the various branches of the church, the fifth and sixth centuries. And I should perhaps explain here that the Eastern Orthodox churches, as I said before, practice biphysitism. There are some Eastern churches.
Nothing. I'm motioning to our waitress for the sacred drink.
Give us a second.
There are some Eastern churches, the Armenians.
What is that you were cheersing
in? And some others that still practice monophysitism to this very day. And there was a council that was held at Chalcedon, where they nailed down biphysitism once and for all as the official basis of the church, and labeled monophysitism as a heresy. And this continued to divide Christians, especially in the East, even during the time of the Eastern Roman Empire, during the reign of the Emperor Justinian, to the point where I should explain that the average person in the street in Constantinople took the same interest in religious questions that somebody in Chicago and Cook County would take in local political ones. I'm not kidding. It became to the point where the two teams, the chariot teams and the hippodrome, the blues and the greens, started riots about it. The riots almost brought down the Emperor Justinian. Finally, he called out the troops under the command of his best general, Belisarius, with instructions to put down the riots. And God only knows how many people they had to kill before they did that. And so when the rioting was so serious that they burned down the original church of Hagia Sophia, Holy Wisdom, the one that Constantine the Great had built, the one that stands there now that the Turks converted into a mosque when they took over Constantinople, today's Istanbul. That's the church that Justinian built to replace the one that got burned down. And as you all know from pictures, if you haven't been to Turkey, I have not, well, no one burned that down. It's still there. Thank you.
All right.
I need just a minute here. Just 1 minute. You know, we
often talk about justification of food and drink by God. You know, coffee's been justified. We go back to Pope Pius. One of the earlier popes. And he proclaimed that this Satan's brew is so delicious, it's a pity to let the infidels have exclusive use of it. No, we shall baptize it, truly call it a Christian beverage.
All right, let's go.
All right.
Good presentation there, Paul. Appreciate it very much, man. Good job, and you held your own with this rough crowd. It's a rough crowd, man. They were digging. They were digging deep, man. I'm looking around the room right now. Tough. Seriously, you held your own, man. My name is Steve. I was born a Roman Catholic. raised a Roman Catholic, and I'll die a Roman Catholic. I believe in God. And I'm going to tell you why I believe in God. Because I don't believe in UFOs, baby. I don't think the Martians created us. And we are the only planet for trillions and trillions and trillions of galaxies, trillions and trillions of stars that have life. We are the only planet that has life.
As far as you know.
So far, exactly, exactly. We, and as creator, created the air, the water, the plants, humans, maybe Martians. I'll go with that, maybe. But for now, it's what I believe. I believe that God, there was a creator, and that creator is called God. That's it. Real simple. There had to be a creator. Look inside our own body. Look inside the brain. It's too complex to just have happened. A baby is born, and the animal world, the cycle, the plants, the oxygen, it's just a beautiful, perfect system that didn't just happen. And I'm hoping somebody proves me wrong on these trillions and trillions of planets out there, that there is some life out there. But so far in trillions of years, or 2,000 years of Earth, no one's ever come here from another planet. I hope somebody can prove that they have. It'll be an interesting time to deal with Martians. It'll be a fun time to have Martians. But for now, I believe in God. That's why I believe in God. There has to be a higher power, a higher creator. It's a creator. That's all it is. And also, in this religion talk, it's a lot of divisiveness with, I'm a Christian, I'm a Jew, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Hindu. It's very divisive. And I know that we all have the same concept in our heart of God. Has anybody ever been to the Baha'i Temple in Wilmette?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, what do you guys think about Baha'i Temple in Wilmette? Is that a good concept or a bad concept?
They don't believe in commentary.
That's all it is. Just everybody believes in God. It doesn't matter what what denomination you are or what religion you are. They just want you to come and praise the joy of our Creator. They just want to come there and give thanks and praise, and all under one roof. So I think the Baha'i Temple has got it right, and the rest of us that keep on wanting to proclaim us as Christians or Jews or Muslims or Hindu have got it wrong. I think we all need to come under one roof together and love each other and praise God as one unit. And that's really it. I just want to thank everybody. Great topic. And let's get some more good stuff going, huh?
All right, Charlie. Yeah.
All right.
Charlie.
How long did I take?
Charlie.
Here's the proof there's life on
the planet.
Charlie.
All right, let's thank our speaker. Thank Paul all the time and effort you put in on this. And nice handouts here. I'll be eclectic as usual here. I just heard that unless we can establish life forms on another planet, all theology is absolutely true. This is why I come to the college, I guess. Also, you say there's some sort of numerology that establishes...
Charlie, I'll show...
John?
I'll show...
The prophecies of John, who supposedly recorded voices that were talking to him from the roof of his cave that he lived in. On the island of Thutmose. So... There's a mathematical analysis to this voice that he wrote down.
I'll show you, Charlie.
That's what I mean. I have to deal with this stuff. I'm very suspect of truth by truth by revelation, which is what almost all of this is. Truth by revelation. There's no criteria established for determining truth, and there's no way for differentiating among prepositions that are advanced. Just some of the things you're talking about, there's some things in here about alleged divinity of Jesus, historical Jesus, at the time of the period of the life of Jesus, there are about, there are recorded events of eight other individuals who allegedly rose from the dead. Jesus is apparently a composite of about 18 different individuals. There are very few, if any, contemporaneous records regarding the life of someone known as Jesus, who was pieced together several centuries, at least one century after he has allegedly existed. Any attempt to arrive at historical accuracy on this is invalid and intellectually unallowable. Regarding the church, I have to be kind of negative. You got to be careful. I used to think it was like Jefferson, that perhaps it's not a bad thing that people go once a week and get some sort of ethical discussion. But then again, I began looking at the priestly class. And you've got to be cautious about the priestly class. They're using Christianity as a very poor vehicle for ethics, as you saw by one of my questions there regarding the commandments. One of the things that Christianity advances, at least from a correction or a judicial point of view, is an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, meaning prisons should be very intolerable places, and is not, in fact, embraced by our judges and court system. It is certainly not used, the ethics that is advanced in scriptures. That's the other thing, you got to watch out about the worldview that's advanced by not only Christianity, but any other religion. It gives you a worldview. The worldview of Christianity is very, very hierarchical. Instead of a process one or a circular one, which is the more popular paradigm these days, it is strictly top to bottom. And that's why you are sent down if you do not conform, if you do not reach the criteria. There's about 10,000 operations here, which none of which we can verify are actually in effect or taking place. The sin and things, these are not like the laws that are operational in the universe. I wish I had a dollar for every time I've heard Bill Wen talk about exegesis and eisegesis. It's just some strange kind of way that makes it sound like interpreting the Bible is some sort of profound, strange endeavor. We are entirely, I will use the term, we are blessed that we had secular humanists known as the philosophes who structured this country. And believe you me, if you read any of these guys, Voltaire, any of them, they have nothing to do with organized religion at all. They are fierce, intense. And when they wrote this amendment, and believe you me, they had it very clear and there was no dispute. If you read these guys, even I find a hard time listening to some of the philosophers when they get into the topic of organized religion. They did not have any regard for it whatsoever. So, and let's see, that's kind of all. But I really wanted to get into whether or not we should have maintained. Oh, wait a minute. You hit on it here. We don't keep this theology out of science. Public policy is based and rooted in verifiable science. And now you're going to get into creation science or something like this gibberish that's out there. That evolution was incapable of this, so that, no, the other guy, that, you know, there was some other process, that's just not going to work with me. You know, and last of all, I like it, every year there seems to be some dispute now about singing Christmas carols and having pageants and get those mangers off our courthouse lawns.
Here, here.
Yeah, get them out of here. All right, thanks.
All right, John.
Oh, there's a mathematics to the prophecies of John?
You're totally misinterpreting what I've said, Charlie.
That's what he does best.
I know.
Yeah,
like socialist.
Charlie,
any more rebuttals? Go ahead. We got time.
Yeah, thanks for the lecture. Thanks for opening up the topic on religion. My name is Dean. First time up for this. I just want to talk about religion, generally religion, nothing about Christianity or anything else. A couple of prophecies I'd like to bring out that religion is sort of demanded by society. Society demands to have it. I think there's other promises that someone said religion is the opium of the masses. Perhaps that's true for some cases, for a lot of people. To have religion, basically, I think you have to have faith, a myth, and you have to have magic. Yes, magic too. Those three things, you should have your trinity in religion. You have to have all those three. And today, you know, we can analyze other people's religions, but we should really respect everybody else's religion, because throughout history, to study religion, go back to prehistoric days, our ancestors roamed around the earth in groups of 35, 40 people. Some were in jungles, deserts, mountains, cold weather, hot weather, water, islands, wherever. And I think my hypothesis is that a lot of religions were formed by different group leaders. I think religion has to control society. They had to control people. People were afraid. People were getting sick, dying. You're afraid of death. That's their thing. Death is the ultimate cause to create religion. And all these illnesses we go through, and injuries, and unexplained incidences. It's a complex issue. It involves a lot of economics, politics, and everything. And it's basically, the premise is we should try to analyze other people's religion before we make any judgment calls on everybody. And that includes paganism, atheism, agnosticism, mysticism, anything. You know, I mean, just trying to figure out what we're looking for, because it's a very, very complex issue. You could bring anything up to this. It's just science. Today, our day and age, we have a lot of science to go by. We have history to look at. We have a lot of other religions from the East, like Buddhism and Hinduism, and you name it. I mean, there's just a lot of philosophical religions out there. A lot of people have religion without believing in God, like Buddhism, for example. I think that they don't believe in God, but they have developed tremendous religious following. I mean, it's a deep, deep thing out there, and it's something we should, you know, people could look and study, and this is something we ponder on in religion. I don't know about this. That's it.
All right. All right, Brom. Yes.
Mike Lehman.
Uh-huh. Okay, Mike.
All right.
Just one real quick thing. The mainstream media and the politicians want you to all to believe these are religious wars in the Middle East, but they really are oil wars.
Uh-oh.
So.
Sacrilege.
As much as they want you to make, you know, it's different religious wars, it's really all oil wars. I don't care if it's Syria, Libya, now Russia getting in there. It's all about infrastructure, Halliburton, oil, territory. Even ISIS is all about land and resources and oil wars.
That's why we need thorium, dude.
Maybe, but... So anyway... That's about all I had to say.
All right.
All right.
Wait, a lot more.
Yes. And if you got something to, go right ahead.
My name's Cindy. This is my first time here.
All right. Oh, wow.
Yes. And I confess, I'm actually an ordained minister. And my friend told me they were going to talk about why I am a Christian tonight. And I thought, well, that's right up my alley. And I think you have a lot of courage to talk about that in front of this group. I am not going to tell you anything about what I think is right or wrong, because that's not why I'm a Christian. I grew up as a Christian, but I didn't really know how to live. I didn't know how to love. I got divorced twice. Uh-oh. I drank too much. I mean, my life was pretty much a mess. And so I started going to church just to try to figure out how to straighten up a big life that wasn't much worth living.
I'll drink to that.
Yeah. So I got led to work for the poor, to feed poor people. And I found that that was really rewarding, that my heart got a little softer. You know, I felt like I was more in connection with people. And then I got led to go to seminary. And because I'm really not very intellectual, it's a bit of a miracle that I graduated. So if you don't believe in miracles, you ought to look at my diploma, because that's really proof that, you know, somebody out there is helping you when you need some help. So I still go to church. I retired from working in the church. And I'm not going to apologize for it. You know, there's good people, there's not such, you know, we're all just works in progress. And there's a lot of political problems, there's a lot of corruption everywhere, you know. But you know, the old prophet Micah said, what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? So, you know, if you all are kind, if you're fair, if you're walking humbly and trying to make the world a better place, you're okay with me.
Okay. All right. All right. Anybody else with rebuttals?
No.
All right.
We got a rebuttal. We will hear from the final rebuttal.
He has just been an alien presence.
All right.
We'll
give you 3 minutes.
Anybody want to read? It's an outstanding example of exegesis. It's a book called Why Is God a Creationist? It's an anthology edited by Royal Mission Fry. That's with the F-R-Y-E.
Back off the mic.
And
You're too close to the microphone.
Too close. All right. He says, Genesis was not written to be taken literally. What it really intended to be, doing an exegesis, not an eisegesis on Genesis, it was a rebuttal to pagan creationists, that the world was created by a bunch of water swirling around, and somehow the world came out of that. Whereas Genesis poses an orderly stages of creation. Somehow I kind of think there's an analogy there between where all you socialists think wealth comes from. But Roland Bushett Fry, F-R-Y-E, it used to be in the Chicago Public Library. I haven't seen it in years.
Was Jesus a capitalist?
That's a discussion in itself.
But they did put
a lot of flesh on the bones. It's sort of my understanding of exegesis versus eisegesis. And people who take Genesis literally, rather than worshiping God, they're putting their own preconceptions into the subject.
Okay, that's gonna. We're going to have to cut off all speakers now because we're running out of time. All right.
The final rebuttal. Let's Paul Rescino.
All right. Here it is, Paul.
I'd like to thank you for letting me speak tonight. And just quickly on some of the comments that were made, I'm glad Tim mentioned Lee Strobel.
Oh, you can?
Yes. Lee Strobel was an atheist and a journalist. And he set out one day to prove that Christianity was wrong and write a book about it. The book he finally wrote was The Case for Christ. In his research, the more he tried to disprove the Bible and Christianity, the more he proved it to himself, and he became a Christian.
All right.
Oh, I better be careful.
Tim talked about apologetics. For those of you who don't understand what apologetics is, in apologetics, we're not apologizing for anything. Apologetics is when you get up and give a defense for what you believe. And the Romans didn't like the Christians. The Romans would accept anybody's religious beliefs, but the Romans didn't like the Christians because the Christians believed there was only one God. And the Romans had quite a few.
The emperor.
Putting the emperor in.
Charlie mentioned Voltaire. I have an interesting quote from Voltaire. Voltaire said, I wish that my wives and friends and servants were all Christians because they would think twice before throttling me. Brahm mentioned the genealogies. The reason the genealogies are important is because throughout the Old Testament, God said that Jesus was going to be, well, from Adam and Eve, from Jacob, from Judah, from David, of the tribe of Judah. That's why the genealogies are important. It traces the line to the Messiah. And the reason there's two genealogies is the one genealogy is the genealogy of the firstborns that leads to Joseph. The second genealogy is the king line through David and Solomon. Solomon was not David's firstborn son. But Solomon became king of Israel. And that line leads to Mary. So in Jesus, you have the recombining of the firstborn and the king lines of Israel.
Okay.
David wasn't the firstborn either.
Well, we're going to have to...
I'm going.
Why don't rebuttal?
Yes, I am. Yes, I am going to celebrate Christmas. Santa Claus presents. What's not to like?
All right.
But
one more.
Christmas is the Christ Mass. In Christmas, we celebrate the great gift. And the reason we give gifts, like I said before, with doing good works, we give gifts because the greatest gift was given to us. As somebody said, I couldn't do anything. I've told this to friends of mine. They ask, well, why are you so nice to me? And I tell them, I couldn't do anything for you if God didn't do it for me first. Thank you.
All right.
I have more of the handouts if anybody should want to take some.
Right, close us out, Brom.
Good job. Good job.
Was very nice. Anyway.
We're adjourned.
We are adjourned. Yeah. The class is dismissed. And we hope to see you next year.
When is recess?
For the next 100 years.
Yeah. Our next meeting's a long time from
now.
Recess is when Charlie was called.